Lalonde, right? How old are you, Flora?
How old? 55.
Available supermarket. Coming up next, Webster.
Good morning. One should never ask a woman her age, especially in these days. But let me put a question very directly to you. Can a woman of 55, Canada's most prominent woman politician, at least in the Conservative Party, the Flora MacDonald, become Prime Minister of this country? We'll ask her. Also this morning, I'm going to talk to two fellows for whom I don't have much sympathy. They're from PIPSC, the Professional Institute of the Public Service of Canada, and they're here to gloat about their indexed pensions, which only civil servants really have. But first this morning, there's an intriguing confrontation, meeting, I should say, between Bob McClellan, British Columbia's Minister of Energy, so far anyway, and the famous Lalonde, Marc Lalonde, who's out here to hit McClellan over the head with a reduced copy of the Alberta Oil Agreement and see if McClellan will give him back the $23 million that BC has withheld on the arrogant Ottawa excise tax on export of natural gas. But first, we're going to start with, not with Flora, with Lalonde after the break. Just a couple of weeks ago, Premier Bennett was dancing with joy, happy with the Alberta agreement with Ottawa on the basis that British Columbia was going to get some of the same benefits, at least in natural gas. And then whammo, the balloon was bust. In town today to negotiate with Bob McClellan, who is our Minister of Energy, is the indomitable Marc Lalonde. Mr. Lalonde, before you lose me in technicalities and agreement and Liberal Party propaganda, it was really disgraceful that it took you 3 years to make that deal with Alberta while the country's economy has been performing like, oh, a dead balloon, flat balloon.
Well, the first thing, Jack, is that you refer to Bob McClellan as our Minister of Energy. I'd like you to refer to me also as our Minister of Energy, because I'm also the Minister of Energy for the whole of Canada, including British Columbia.
Do you think maybe I was showing a tiny touch of subconscious alienation as a person who lives on the
maybe,
West Coast?
Maybe. But anyway, I like to think of myself as being the Minister of Energy for all Canadians, not only for a particular group or a particular region.
And I'll certainly concede that, because I remember Mr. Trudeau sitting here and boasting in the previous election campaign that we had to vote Liberal and we'd get cheaper oil and gas. Hasn't turned out that way, has it?
Cheaper than it would have been under the Conservative program. We never said cheaper than it was at that time, but we committed ourselves during the election that it would be cheaper oil and gas than under the Conservative budget, and that's what you got.
The facts of the matter being, of course, that no matter what it was, oil and gas prices have to come up in domestic Canada to 75% of world level.
Maximum, a maximum of 75%. It will never go above 75% for old oil. And that's also very different from under the Conservative budget, where it was going to go to 85% in 1984. So that's a very significant difference.
As far as my first question is concerned, is it correct that you have informed British Columbia's Minister of Energy that you won't even talk to him until he pays back the $23 or $25 million that the BC government arrogantly withheld, defying your excise tax in your budget?
Well, it is certainly something that is very reprehensible that a particular government or government agencies would refuse to pay taxes that have been passed by a law of parliament. But I have never indicated I would refuse to talk to them. The best evidence is I'm meeting with them this morning, even though they have not paid their taxes. But obviously this is a very crucial point and very important point. I think this would be intolerable in any part of the country. Suppose that British Columbia were to try and collect its own taxes from its citizens and they would say we won't pay. That's not acceptable.
The National Minister of Energy indicates strongly to Webster that there will be no progress in the BC-Ottawa Energy Oil Agreement until Bennett and McClellan put that $23, $25 million check on the table, at least in a proposition.
Well, that's part certainly part of the negotiations and part of the agreement. And as I say, it's very, very difficult to negotiate in good faith when one of the participants breaks the law. So we have to obey the laws of the country.
Now, I presume that you're quite prepared, however, to give British Columbia the same natural gas deal that you gave to Ottawa. They give to
Alberta.
Alberta.
Yes, the same agreement, total agreement, frankly, with the same conditions. Alberta has made some concessions. We've made some concessions. So if British Columbia is willing to sign the same agreement as with Alberta, we're quite happy with that.
That will remove the export tax on natural gas.
That would remove the export tax on natural gas, but except on butane and propane, as you know.
But it will remain, the excise tax will remain on natural gas.
Yes, all the domestic taxes would remain on natural gas and oil all across the country.
Will the same incentives apply to any considerable amounts of oil that may be found in British Columbia as are in the Alberta agreement?
Very definitely so, yes.
So therefore it looks like you can negotiate probably in 1 or 2 days with McClellan, subject to that basic provision that took you 3 months with Lougheed and Leach.
Well, it certainly should be much faster, but as you know, it takes two to make an agreement, and I don't know exactly what Mr. McClellan has in mind in terms of the British Columbia position and their offer. As far as we are concerned, our position is quite clear. If British Columbia is ready to sign the Alberta agreement, we can have it all over by 10 o'clock this morning.
And give you that check for $23, $25 million.
Definitely so.
Definitely so. Now, I had Broadbent here last week, and Broadbent runs a pretty good line, which many people accept. We cannot understand why there can't be a two-price level for fuels in this country. Charge what you like for export, but for domestic use, Canadians should be able to get cheap gas at the gas stations. Is that just socialist garbage, NDP economic nonsense?
No, we're getting that. The best evidence of that is that we are selling some oil to the United States, heavy oil, at world prices, while we're selling them in Canada at a much lower price. And under the Alberta Energy Agreement, all the way down the line to the end of 1986, we will be having oil prices in this country that will be much lower than let's say, the United States. The oil, we have a policy of having a price made in Canada which is different from the OPEC price and the United States prices. Maybe Broadbent would like it to be even lower.
Yes.
Well, but that's typical NDP, you know. They say lower everything and think that the things that you'll find more oil. You have to, you know, if you have to want to have the tar sands plant, it costs a lot more money than to have traditional old oil coming out of wells.
You raise a very important point there. Imperial Oil is digging in its heels. The multinational oil companies obviously do not like your new agreement with Ottawa. Mm. There's been, if not an attack, or something close to an attack on oil and gas stocks in this country. Now, why do the big multinational Americans hate your new deal so much? When one took a superficial look at it, one thought, oh great, X billions extra to the feds, X billions extra to Alberta, billions and billions to the oil company, and yet they don't like it, do they?
Well, some do, to begin
Dome
with.
Dome likes it. Dome will live with it.
Nova and a lot of others. Even Bill Daniels, the president of Shell, came out very positive on the whole deal, and several spokesmen for the industry have spoken quite positively. Some have expressed some reservations. For instance, Imperial on the Cold Lake project has a concern, and the Oil Sands Group also has concerns. We've indicated that it was up to them to prove that the deal was not quite good enough for them. And we, Alberta, the government of Alberta and ourselves, are going to sit down and work out a commercial deal. They will have to establish beyond any doubt that what the both governments felt was adequate is not adequate for some reason, with regard to the tar sands. As far as the rest is concerned, I think that is quite good enough for the industry. They've got $95 billion coming to them over the next 6 years. That's $10 billion more than they had they were expected to receive under the budget of last year. That's a lot of money.
Not enough for them, though. They like to control the whole thing, don't they, and do as they wish.
In 20 years, I've never seen an oil company come around and say, I have had enough money, thank you, stop sending me money. They always ask for more.
The fear that they have, of course, is that your Canadianization... By the way, does Lougheed agree with your Canadianization?
Yes, sir. Not only does he agree with it now, that he's going to administer part of the program, he's going to essentially administer our Canadianization program in Alberta. Inside Alberta. So that is a very, very welcome change of heart and position on the part of the government of Alberta.
Sure annoys the U.S. government. It sure annoys Reagan, doesn't it?
Well, I don't think it annoys Mr. Reagan that much. It annoys the oil lobby over there, which is quite powerful and is pushing pressure on Congress and the administration.
Before he goes off to see Bob McClellan, another segment with Marc Lalonde. Our and his. And so is he, our and his. What a... hair-splitting performance of energy in Canada after the break. Marc Lalonde, Federal Minister of Energy, meeting today with Bob McClellan. Oh, poor Bob was humiliated into the ground. Did you hear about it?
Yes, I read some reports in the press, I think, over the weekend.
Well, let me put it to you this way. BC government arbitrarily decided they would use the BC Hydro to bring natural gas to Vancouver Island on a longer and more expensive route. And a man who was regarded as being in your camp, Ed Phillips of West Coast Transmission, screamed and ranted and raved about it because he wants the gas to come through Powell River across to Vancouver Island. And now Bennett has backed down, leaving McClellan with egg all over his face. Did you have anything to do with that?
No, very definitely not. I must say that... We were rather, let's say, to use a mild word, surprised by the decision that had been announced about the BC Hydro pipeline. Frankly, our view was that this was probably not the best route and certainly not the cheapest route by any means. So we frankly privately hoped that the government of British Columbia would revisit this situation. And I'm glad to hear that now they have come to the conclusion that they would like to re-examine this issue. It's a decision that, we will cooperate with the government of British Columbia in examining if they want us to cooperate. But the fact is that we want this decision. I think it should be made on pure economics.
Yeah, to be even more blunt, if Hydro built it on its own and was not under the National Energy Board control, no subsidy, if it comes from West Coast, which is under the National Energy Board, you might help with the costs. Is that not correct?
Well,
are you committed to help with the costs of a gas program of which you approve?
We have indicated under the National Energy Program that we would have funds available to help on the gas pipeline to the Vancouver Island. We believe that this gas pipeline should have been built many years ago, as a matter of fact.
In fact, you're coming here as a good fairy this morning, say here. You cooperate with us on the West Coast line across to Vancouver Island, we might be able to cooperate with you.
Well, I'm not coming here to put any conditions to the government of British Columbia on that. Not at all. We have indicated a commitment in principle to support the construction of that line. I'm not going to come and tell the British Columbia government, you do this or do that. I hope it will be discussed in good faith on both sides.
I get the message. If BC signs the equivalent of the energy oil deal that you signed with Alberta, what does it mean to us in terms of escalating income and growth? Or must we wait for further development and discoveries down the road before it means anything to us?
Well, when you say to us, I see if you talk about the British Columbia government,
taxpayer,
not necessarily the British Columbia people.
I'm thinking of the British Columbia people.
It will bring more money to the companies, and it will bring more money to the government. As far as bringing more money to the people, that will be the British Columbia government to decide whether it wants to lower taxes or give them a better break on their purchases of oil and gas. The price of natural gas in British Columbia is decided exclusively by the British Columbia government. We can have a federal tax like on all Canadians, including British Columbians, but the price itself is one that is decided by British Columbia. So I can't answer what the net result of the agreement would be on the consumer or the taxpayer, except to say that there would be more money for the industry to do the job, discover more oil and gas in British Columbia, which would be good for British Columbia, no doubt about it, and more revenues for the British Columbia government, which would mean that they would be able to do more of the things the governments do. But
will it encourage the
depends. It depends again what will happen with exports and everything. I wouldn't say necessarily that it will mean more government, more revenues to the British Columbia government than under the National Energy Program, because under the NEP we had provided for a very generous arrangement for British Columbia.
This will increase the wellhead price and this encourage development.
Should, certainly.
Should do that much at least.
Sure.
Because our exports, as you know, are way off right now.
Right, very much.
Badly down. Yeah. And now that the Americans seem to be chickening out on the Alaska Highway Pipeline full build, and we've only got the pre-build, are you afraid that the Americans will double cross us on this Alaska Highway Pipeline, which is of great importance to Alberta and some to BC?
Up to now, the indications we have is that they are still very committed to it. Information we have inside the administration or in Congress is that there is a very strong support for it. And the Alaska representatives in the Senate and House are also very, very strong for it, and they are very powerful in the Congress at the present time. So we have no reason to believe at the present time that this will not go ahead. We certainly, as far as we're concerned, we hold the Congress and the administration to their formal commitment that they gave us by resolutions passed in Congress. And it would certainly be going back on their words terribly, like I don't think they have done for many, many decades in terms of our relationship.
But you're well aware of the avalanche of anti-Canadianism in lobbying around Reagan just now.
Right.
I mean, it's the worst you've seen in many, many years, is it not?
Yes, it's a very strong lobby. The oil lobby in the United States has always been very powerful, and frankly, because I'm
not
surprised.
And it's because of your Canadianization program, is it not?
In good part, sure.
Because you might even buy out Imperial Oil one of these days.
Well, we don't have a plan to that effect
right
now.
Would you like to?
It is not necessarily, in my view, it's not necessarily the best purchase that Canadians could make if the government of Canada or Petro-Canada had to go and buy a corporation.
Would you like to buy a major multinational company in this country?
It is part of our program that during this decade, a number of the multinationals operating in Canada will have become under Canadian ownership and control by 1990. Some of this, and I hope most of that, will take place via the private sector, however, and there are indications that this is going to proceed.
The only trouble with these buyouts is that surely, Mr. Lalonde, they are for pride and don't give us at the moment an extra bucket of oil.
Well, I would challenge this view because, in effect, all the evidence we have up to now is that the Canadian oil companies or Canadian-owned companies have a better record of reinvesting inside Canada than the multinationals. And if you own the company, it will tend to reinvest in this country more than the multinationals.
We haven't looked at the state of the nation. You must be embarrassed.
No. I'm concerned about some areas, but there are some very, very good points. I told you just before the program, inflation rate is down. Yes, that's right, it's coming down.
Half a point.
Well, it's, thank God, it's in the right direction. If it were going the reverse, you would be blasting me this morning.
Do you own your own house?
The interest rate, yes, I do.
And no mortgage?
No mortgage, I've paid it off, thank God, but we're very concerned about that. And as the government has indicated, we're looking at means where we can come to the help of those most in need if necessary. But the solution is to try and get those interest rates down gradually for everybody. And that's what we've been pushing for. The dollar was up in the weekend on Friday. So unemployment is lower than it has been for 5 years.
It's nil.
Yeah, well, that is something significant. And the economy is growing in Canada more than any other industrialized country at the present time. So there are some positive elements. Inflation is worrisome. Interest rate is very worrisome.
You have not yet been Minister of Finance?
No.
Would you do like McKechnie did? Really, it's quite comical. He says, well, we're going to ask the banks to be nice to people. And we're going to say, oh, an 18% mortgage, which means you'd capitalize your overdue interest. Really, that's living in a fool's paradise.
Well,
18% and capitalizing your interest is as bad as any other deal.
Well, first of all, what is important is that you try and prevent people losing their homes. That is the first thing, frankly, because this is fundamental to a family. And
agreed.
There, what you have, for instance, is these representations to the banks have not been useless. The Royal Bank came out with a statement that they had half as much foreclosures this year and last year, in spite of the high interest rates. So our pressure on the banks has been helpful to the consumer at the present time. It is true that as long as the interest rates are high, it's a very heavy burden on families. And the solution is for everybody to try and get those interest rates down and try to help those that are most in need. And that is what we are looking at, whether anything can be done.
Because no government can really do it. It's just a question of health of the country.
Well, it depends a lot on what the Americans are doing again. You know, as long as you've got 20% interest rates in the United States, it's not easy to keep interest rates very low in this country. You know, every citizen would ship out its money to the American banks to make money on it. So all the Western world, industrialized countries, have been putting pressure on the American administration, saying your policy is too strong in that respect. And I'm reasonably confident that the American administration is beginning to have second thoughts on the higher interest rates they have at the present time. And if they do, I think it will help us a lot.
But the next time you're back, interest is still about 15%.
Well, it will be 5 points below what they have been lately. So it will have moved in the right direction. I would be much more embarrassed if I came back and said it was 25%, eh?
You'll be much better off anyway, because when you finish today, you'll have a check for $23-25 million in your pocket from Bob McClelland.
I don't. I'm not sure he's going to walk in with a check, but I would hope that we would resolve this issue.
My thanks to Marc Lalonde, one of the real eminences. I can't say it in French; it sounds funny. Grey eminence, eminence grise.
You're doing very well.
Of the Liberal cabinet. Flora MacDonald, a member of the Tory shadow cabinet, has been sitting here fuming at what's his name, Lalonde. Oh, you can have a bash at him after the break. Flora MacDonald, Shadow Cabinet in the Tories, member for Kingston and the Islands, and she'd been sitting here agreeing with everything that Lalonde told me in that pre-tape program done early this morning. They kept their promise. They beat you. The gas is cheaper now than it would have been. Everything in the country is just absolutely wonderful. And the Lord's in his heaven.
Well, you know, it's a long time since I've heard anybody explain that the economy of the country was in such great state as Mr. Lalonde did this morning when he was signing off. But what I noticed most was when he came on and you threw the first few questions to him, the embarrassment of Lalonde and Trudeau and the rest of them at having to defend what is indefensible. That is, they said, there's no question, everybody remembers it. They said before the election, vote Liberal and the price of gas will stay down. In fact, they put a price on it. They said, look, it won't go up more than 14 cents a gallon. Well, it's gone up 60 cents a gallon in many parts of the country. The federal government alone has taken 36 cents in taxes, far more than the 18 cents we said we'd take. But he sits there and he tries to cover it up with all kinds of words and all kinds of explanations and all kinds of technicalities. And the plain truth is, he's lying.
Surely the plain truth is that you were wrong not to lie in that campaign. And the ipso facto, the next time you run for the government of this country, you generically, you'll have to lie.
No, I don't think we do have to lie.
You must lie.
Look, people are not going to accept the fact, as they're not accepting the fact now, that the Liberal government lied to them. You see it, whether it happens to be in the Gallup poll or in by-election results, or the way people talk to me on the streets here in Vancouver. They are absolutely furious with the federal government at the present time. Now, sure, we've got ourselves locked into 4 years of that kind of arrogant rule. But there's no doubt that if there was an election held tomorrow, the Liberal government would be out on its ear.
Well, it might depend, of course, on what good Tories like Brampton Billy do this time round. You'll remember that Mr. Davis spent most of his time in bed with Mr. Trudeau, didn't he?
Well,
one of the great shames of the Conservative Party in the last election.
I would venture to predict that the province that would change most quickly in any election at the present time would be Ontario, mm-hmm. because they're absolutely fed to the teeth with the fact, not only fed to the teeth, they too are embarrassed that they were taken in by what the Liberal government had to say. They realize now how naive they were and how, in a sense, culpable they were in swallowing that kind of...
I was going to attack you on the interest rates because your orthodox financial establishment is identical with the Liberals. You operate under the same pressures and the same understandings of economy. Your only escape, of course, is that your government had promised mortgage deductibility.
Well, that's true. And not only that, we had gone through the proposed budget, the estimates of spending for the year that we were coming into office. And we had taken 4 to 6 weeks to do it. And each one of us, every cabinet minister, had to go through and pare the expenditures down, cut out the fat. And we cut the deficit down to $9.6 billion.
What is it now? $14 billion.
That's the way they jacked it up when they came back into office. But we did it, and in that sense, it would have established confidence in the Canadian dollar, that you were beginning to bring the deficit under control. And even having brought the deficit under control, we were still able to build in the mortgage tax credit.
Mm-hmm. Pity you're not a united party and that there are still so many knives out for your leader.
Well, a lot of that, really, Jack, I've got to tell you, appears in the press far more than it does within the caucus and within the party. And I'm one of the people who hears things a lot. I mean, a great many people within the party talk to me because I've known them over the years. And they're concerned that there is so much talk in the press or in the media about it. They're not talking to me about it. They're saying, how do we get on and win?
Well, of course, there was a significant change in the shadow cabinet.
Yes.
And that significant change was, which one was the most significant? Come on now.
Well, I suppose...
You can't blame it on the media because...
I suppose that the person who dominated the House of Commons, other than Mr.
Joe
Clark, was...
Crosby.
Absolutely. And he's now moved to a position that I think is an excellent position. That is chairman of the Foreign and Defense Policy Committee. It's a very... not only exciting but demanding area, particularly in this time when there are so many troubled spots in the world.
It's not quite such a good center star spot, though, for wisecracks about the money or for slashing McKechnie, who's quite easily slashed into little pieces.
Well, I have a feeling that John Crosby is still going to be making comments in this field, as I anticipate being able to make comments in the foreign policy field, even though I have a different responsibility at this time.
Are you disappointed with your new portfolio in the shadow cabinet?
No, because you see, what this does is bring me far more into contact with people. What social policy or social development really entails is the human face of politics. This is where the things that concern people, housing and health and welfare, immigration and consumer affairs, pensions, all of these things are what I will be dealing with in the months ahead. And of course, it's going to be a much more active role in the House of Commons.
Chrétien, there was a report out of Ottawa on Friday that Chrétien is prepared to cut $11 billion from the transfer payments to the provinces for various shared cost programs. What will it hit? And would you not have done the same thing, first of all? You'd have done the same thing.
Well, not in the way they're going about it, and not to that extent. But let me tell you, he made that cut of, or proposed that cut of $11 billion just after the federal government has got a windfall of $14 billion from the new energy agreement.
Out of the oil
deal. It doesn't make any sense when they've got this additional money that they turn around and hit individuals. Now, one group that it's going to hit and hit hard are students, whether they're in university or in community colleges, trade schools, because the most of that cut, they prophesy, is going to be in post-secondary education.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Just at the time when we need to train a whole lot of skilled workers, they're the ones that are going to be hit with higher tuition fees. Mm-hmm. And where are the young people going to get that money? Now, I just don't know.
Is there not a limit to how much the government should look after everybody, apart from those people who really need looking after? Don't the students have it too easy?
Well, there's a question.
Doesn't everybody have it too easy?
There's a question, obviously, that we shouldn't be helping everyone that to get everything. Universality is a concept that I question. But I do think that when you're investing in something, that is investing in your youth to get trained to take on the jobs that are open in the country, the areas where there are shortages, that is not throwing money away or wasting money. That's good investment.
Do you have any faith, really, in the structure of this country, the vast medical establishment, civil servants establishment, index pensions, unlimited expenditure on almost anything when our productivity, despite what Lalonde says, is not effectively going up at all? Don't you think we're a country that's just eating its own young?
Well, yes, but look, Jack, when you talk about productivity, one of the reasons that there is not an increase in productivity in this country is that there's no confidence here in what the country can do because of the way the government is running the economy, and there's no confidence internationally in what this country can do because they look at us and they see us fighting with one another, whether it happens to be East against West or provinces against the federal government or one group of people against another. That doesn't inspire much confidence.
Or civil service strikes.
All of that is adding to the lack of confidence in the Canadian dollar, in the Canadian economy, and that lowers our productivity.
In fact, it's much lower now than it was as the Diefenbach. The Diefenbach was only 92 cents.
92 cents, and of course the Liberals laughed at to scorn.
82 cents they've reached.
Yes, 81 it went down to at one point last
month.
More
with Flora MacDonald. Hate Liberals now, on the phones too if you want to, or the NDP, or the Tories, I don't care. I'm a cynic after the break. Totally unfairly. First of all, I gave you Flora's age, which she doesn't look at.
Well, I wonder if you did that because I'm a woman. Would you have done the same thing if it had been a man sitting here?
Yes.
You really would?
Yes.
Jack, how old are you?
63, going on 64.
Delighted to know it.
And I always do. I always point out ages. Trudeau is 1 year younger than me, but he didn't tell the truth about his age in the beginning.
No, that's very true. I remember he cut 2 years off.
I asked Lalonde his age this morning, and to my utter astonishment and surprise, he is only 52. He could pass for 55 or 56. Any time at all. No, I'm not
it's
shy about ages.
It's the burdens of office that are weighing heavily.
The reason I ask ages of women is because I ask ages of men. If there's going to be equality and liberty, they've got to stand up the same kind of attitudes
in public.
Well,
I've never had any difficulty with regard to anybody asking my age because I figure if you've packed as much as I have into a lifetime, you've got to be 55 to get it all there.
Backwards question. See, I am delicate. I really am quite delicate.
No, go right ahead.
Do you still have aspirations to lead the Conservative Party? First question.
None at all.
This moment?
No, not even at this moment. I'm here, I'm doing my job, and I'm getting on with it.
If it became clear that if Joe stepped down, would you have a bash for the leadership again? Now, that's a hypothetical question, but
sure.
It's a fair one, because you had a bash before.
Yes, and I think a lot of people would expect me to take a run at it. I'd have to assess the whole thing then. I'm not at the moment even considering, and I say that quite honestly. I feel that's not my role at the present.
You blame the media, the boys in Ottawa, largely, who drink their own bathwater, their collective bathwater, an incestuous little group. You blame the media largely for all this talk about discontent over Joe. Are you a solid supporter of Joe Clark as leader of the Conservative Party?
There's no question about it, and not only that, he knows it extremely well. And, you know, we've been friends going back to the early 1960s, so we can talk to one another pretty frankly about the difficulties, and there are some in the party, we don't deny that.
Can he beat Trudeau?
I think certainly
he can beat Trudeau.
Certainly he can beat Trudeau. Honestly, Mr. Trudeau is probably the most disliked person that we've had in Canada in this century.
Not bad.
I really think so.
Disliked. Yeah, you chose that word carefully. The politician most disliked in Canada since 1900 is whom?
Pierre Elliott Trudeau.
You can't think of anybody else. Does anybody come close?
No, I really do feel that people are at the point where they're fearful about their futures, they're anxious, they're disquieted, And it focuses on the one person who doesn't seem to care about them, doesn't seem to care about Canadian individuals. He has a lot of care and concern about where he goes elsewhere in the world, but when it comes to the person who is suffering here, and there are many, he doesn't seem to penetrate his mind. And people resent that.
Can this country cope, though, with its economic problems at all? I mean, can we really cope with it? Right. Are we not merely a tail of the Yankee dog?
Jack, we happen to be one of the most blessed countries in the world. The resources, the people, the human potential. But we've got to get it all together. And that's
What do we need to make people more enthusiastic? A little war of some kind?
No, I don't think it needs to be an anti-American stance, or I don't think it needs to be an internal difficulty. What really saps our strength is this ongoing strife and tension within the country. And if you don't think that we've had that in the last year, just wait till this next year when it becomes a dollars and cents proposition and the federal government starts cutting the provinces back on the shared cost programs. You see, here's Mr. McKechnie going to take all this money out of the shared cost programs that go to each one of us.
Right.
But what he turns around and asks for is $2 million to extend the runway on his airport, his little airport at Port Hawkesbury in Cape Breton, because he's got to get the government jet into Port Hawkesbury. It's not large enough to carry him when he flies down there. So he went to Federal Treasury Board three times to insist that he get his $2 million to extend that runway. He's not paying the same attention to any other Canadian.
Where does McKechnie live?
He lives in Inverness County in Cape Breton.
Where's the airport?
Port Hawkesbury.
How far is that from his place?
Oh, it's about 30 miles.
And the airport was too small for a Jetstar. So he went to whom? The Treasury Board.
Treasury Board.
And said, I want $2 million so that I can extend the
Port Hawkesbury runway.
So that I can land and get home for tea.
That's right.
Did he get it?
Yes. You see, the Federal Minister of Transport went to bat for him.
We gave $2 million for McKechnie to get home for tea.
Well, that's it, you know, or any weekend or any evening he wants to go.
That's dreadful, isn't it?
Well, it's the kind of thing that's going on, but there isn't the concern. That $2 million given to help out people like the elderly women who are in real difficulty in this country would assist a great number of them.
Well, you've always been a spokesman for them. In fact, it was you that fought and got the pension to continue for the 60-year-old women whose husbands had died
that's
over 65.
That's
you
right.
did that in opposition, or did you do that in power?
Well, I raised the issue over and over again in opposition, and it was the first bill that we put through when we came into office, that those women who got cut off the old age pension, if they were under the age of 65 and their husbands were over it and the husband died, and they suddenly were cut off. They didn't receive any pension.
Yeah, they're the forgotten Canadians.
Now they continue to receive that.
Elderly people on the old age pension who don't have the Canada pension plan or only have a small part of it are the ones who are really the poor Canadians.
Well, look at the situation. Pensions is something that I'm very concerned about. Look at the situation with regard to women. Women who work in the home can't pay into the Canada pension plan. So they can't get anything out of it unless it's a minor survivor's benefit.
Mm-hmm.
There is no such thing in our legislation as splitting of private pension on marriage breakup. And you know how many marriage breakups there are now. So the man walks away at the time of the divorce holding on to all the pension.
Well, no, in BC he can get an order under the Marital Relations Act to split the pension down the road.
Well, then this is the only province where that it doesn't exist across the country.
Well, to put it on the other side, even if she marries again, she still gets a bit of his pension from the settlement.
Well, perhaps, and not if she moves elsewhere in the country.
Yeah, maybe not. Anyway, these are the.
But all of these things, you see, women are there are tremendous inequities in the pension situation with regard to women. I think it's something like 50% of the women between 20 and 65 mm-hmm. are paying into the Canada pension plan, those who are working. 50% of the women in that age group.
And they're getting
96% of the men in that age group are able to pay into the Canada pension plan.
Flora MacDonald, social critic.
Social policy critic. Yes.
Housing, the lot. Immigration.
That's right. Health and welfare, all of these things that touch on people's lives.
Yeah, one day you're going to have to hammer these doctors. After the break. To Flora MacDonald, Conservative, in case you didn't know, Kingston and the Islands. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I have two questions for Miss MacDonald, and she can answer them as she wants. First question is, when are they going to increase our defense budget? And second question is, why should women who are married, divorced from a fellow who died on pension, if she gets remarried to another man, why should she get his pension?
Well, first of all, the question of the defense budget. When we were the government, we did increase the defense budget by 3% over the cost of inflation annually for the next 5 years. And I'm trusting that the federal government will hold to that, because our military machine has run down tremendously in this country. But that was one of the steps that we took, and in fact, I announced it at the NATO meeting in Brussels. And secondly, with regard to women's pensions, one of the things that really the woman contributes by her own work in supporting her husband while she's married to him, allowing him to do certain things, she contributes to that pension, and she should have some equality within the pension. And so that when marriage breakup comes, there should be a splitting of that. I firmly believe that that's so. It may be that she remarries, but it may be that she doesn't remarry. It may be that the person whom she remarries has no pension plan. A number of things could happen. She herself, as an individual, should have some independence.
Okay, then.
Thank you. Mind you, it's getting to ridiculous stage in some ways when you, the new generation, not my generation, or even the people around here, where you've got the two professional incomes in the family in future. I think it's got to cut both ways, and the guy's got to get half of her pension, especially if she's an index pension civil servant.
I couldn't agree with you more, Jack. It has to work both ways. The problem is it's only worked one way in the past.
And the laws are now very confused. And, of course, in this country, we never have one clear national law for anything common sensible, do we?
And the other thing about it is that women themselves don't take advantage of the opportunities that are there. You can now split the Canada pension plan. That is part of the law of the land. But
as long as it lasts.
Yeah, but of the 86,000 divorces that have taken place in this country in the last couple of years, only 270 women have applied for splitting of the Canada pension plan. They either don't know about it, or they take a cash settlement instead, and they don't look down the road to the future. So it's not all one-sided.
Question, I hope you can answer it. Is this a matter for a court decision, or if a woman is divorced or a guy with CPP, is it an administrative act to split the pension?
It's up to the lawyer to inform the woman about that being one of the prerogative she can take.
Therefore, ma'am, if you've divorced your husband recently and he's on a Canada pension plan, make sure that you get half his CPP, and you can always, under the BC legislation, go back for a review every 5 minutes, it would seem. Go ahead, please.
Yes, this may not be pertaining to your subject, but the other Friday night on CB...
What is your point?
Pardon?
What's your point?
They were shown where the headman of Transpo 86, they were renting his an apartment.
Oh, yes, very good indeed. The headman of Transpo 86 has got it was on BC TV News, has a fantastic apartment rented on his behalf between now and 1987 at $4,000 a month. It's one floor, going up to $7,000, and he contributes, Patrick Reed, he contributes $500 a month.
Now, of course, I've got to tell you that as head of Transpo 86, 87, 86, he must have a beautiful place, but a place could have been got in Vancouver for $2,500 a month, beyond lavish, beyond belief. So it's a sliding scale of $4,000 to $7,000.
Jack, that is the kind of thing that absolutely infuriates me, and I'm glad this lady brought it
up. So
am I. Because, as I mentioned, when we were in government, we went through the expenditures item by item, and we cut down on the fat that were the expenditures by the civil service. One of the things I did was to make all civil servants in my department travel ordinary class travel as I did.
Economy.
Instead of traveling first class as they had. Why should they travel first class across the country or wherever it is? And, you know, these are the economies that add up and add up if you put them into place.
That's a good one. And Reid said on the television interview, and that must be accurate, that it had been done by the Public Works Department. Who's the Minister for Public Works?
The Minister for Public Works is also Mr. Cosgrove. The housing.
That's a great one. Up to $7,000 a month, and he could have got one for $2,500, maybe rising to four. He's got to have a knobby place, I suppose, for diplomats and whatnot.
Well, I suppose so, but as minister, I had an ordinary apartment in Ottawa. It didn't occur to me that I had to have anything extraordinary.
But you had that $100 million fortress up there with all the
well,
fancy...
That's true, and that's a very elaborate building.
The ugliest building in Ottawa, isn't it? What's it called again?
It's the Lester B. Pearson building.
Ugliest building in Ottawa. It is. Ghastly. Furnishings alone cost billions.
It has a beautiful view.
Plants all around the top for the afternoon cocktail parties. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yeah.
Flora MacDonald?
Yes.
I would like to suggest that as one who voted conservative the last two elections, I was rather disappointed with you when you were in government from the standpoint of... sounding like a liberal in the matter of immigration, the matter of foreign aid, and I think you will agree that you came close to being defeated, as was Atkey, the Minister of Immigration under the Conservatives. And while you're a very fine person, I don't deny that you mean well, you're not a conservative.
Well, I...
conservative enough. And I would suggest certainly that you... realize that the people out west have been taken for a ride under the immigration policy, and we certainly should be thinking in terms of charity commencing at home.
Okay, good point. I want you to cut back on reunification of families and immigration, which has certainly put a lot of pressure on housing and other facilities here.
Well, one of the decisions that I certainly made and that I take some pride in is the fact that as government, we extended to the refugees in Southeast Asia a policy of bringing in up to 50,000 refugees. And what I have found of great interest is that within a year of their arrival, that was the period in which they were supported by the Canadian people, within a year of their arrival, 80% of them were on their own, were working and were making an income and were not a burden on the government anymore.
There is a fairly strong underlying resentment to any immigration from Southeast Asia in many parts of Canada, whether you like it or whether you lump it. But your attitude is one of generosity and graciousness within limits.
Well, certainly, and we place certain conditions on it. We had the Canadian people involved in it all the way.
Nanaimo, please, go ahead.
Laura, I was wondering just where you stood on the apprenticeship plans through the government.
Well, that's a too broad a question, really, to deal with. Where do you stand on apprenticeship plans through the government?
Well, let me...
the thing is,
it's a question...
I would like to say that my son went to school in the end of June through July and most of August.
Mm-hmm.
And because it was through the union, his unemployment insurance was cut off totally. Now, had he been on a government-sponsored plan, he would have been paid that and able to support himself while he was in...
Let me ask a question. Could he afford to pay the fees?
I beg your pardon?
Did he have enough money to pay the fees?
No, sir. It was a union sponsored
plan. You want him to stay on...
And we had to support him while he was in school.
How old is he?
20.
Well, couldn't you support him?
Yes, sir. But I want to know why the discrimination between... a government-sponsored plan where they can claim unemployment insurance.
Well, I'm not sure that after 3 months of school...
If it's a union-sponsored plan...
Ma'am, I'll do a program on it one of these days, because I understand the Pacific Vocational Instructional Place is only one-third used. Unions, of course, throttle a lot of the apprenticeship plans, too. Don't forget
that.
Yes,
but I still think the question has to be raised as to whether or not people who are on a three-month training program, after they come off of it, should be then entitled to draw unemployment insurance for the next 9 months.
No, they shouldn't.
You see, this is really what the lady was implying.
Unemployment insurance is unemployment insurance.
Yeah, well, this is the way
training.
I would look at it, too.
There may be discrimination because if the government puts you in, if you're just... landed in the country and the government puts you in, you get support payments. And you therefore get Canadians here who get no support payments, who get very, what's another word for bitchy?
upset about it.
Right.
Another short segment before after the break. Flora MacDonald. You know who she is anyway. Just call her Flora. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yes, that's you.
Oh, because I was cut off on the break.
What was that about?
Okay, what I wanted to know was how much tax does the hydro and the minerals in Quebec and Ontario, how is their tax compared with the oil?
I really can't give you a figure. I'd like to be able to, but I simply do not have that information at my fingertips.
I've just taken seven. Oh, go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jack, I'd just like to touch on something that you did, and that is, have we not reached the point where we have too much government, and we expect the government to do everything for us? And will we ever see a day where the government will do less and be more defined in some major areas? And with that, I'll leave you to pick up on the thread.
Well, I'll continue it, if I may, because I agree with that. The government tries to do everything for everybody. Now, government has to be the last resort to help out. And there are going to be people whom we have always helped and who will be needed to be helped. There are incentives that government can provide for small business or for farmers in order to allow them to do things. But beyond that, government shouldn't get in and regulate everything until it literally squeezes the life out of activity. It should be there to help the people who need it most.
Surely we've got past universality.
Oh, I think so, too.
But, of course, if you say means test, you're an imperialist fascist pig.
Well, you know, I'm not sure that is so. Look at the guaranteed income supplement. Now, I don't
know... That's a means test.
It's
a good one.
I don't know of anybody who doesn't take advantage of it, who doesn't, if they need it, go and apply through their income tax form for the guaranteed income supplement. And they don't feel that there's any stigma attached to that.
But if some kid from a wealthy family gets a place, we'll say at Kitimat Terrace or Prince George in a vocational training school, there's no question of him saving money to go to the school.
I want a kind of a manpower training grant. You know?
Well, there should be ways in which we support the people who need it most.
I think far too soft and far too easy. Of course, all the laws are written by the civil servants now. They're not written by the politicians. That's the problem.
Obviously, it comes up through the civil service. I know that that some ministers have great arguments with civil servants about whether or not this is the best way to go. One of the difficulties that I found is that when it gets to the top of the civil service bureaucracy, the minister is usually given only one option. Mm-hmm. And that's the civil service way of trying to run the cabinet.
I still think in your next campaign you've got to go hard after all of the solicitors general, including Holman, because they all knew what was going on in the McDonald Commission scandals. Oh. But none of them apparently said, hey, look, Commissioner or Deputy Commissioner, what's this for? Who is it you're trying to get?
Yeah.
Are you going to go after this French diplomat? Are you going to do this? Tell me what happened. If I were the minister, I'd want to know, one, if they'd done it, if I'd okayed it, and then what happened when they'd finished.
I would say, Jack, that that's going to be one of the major issues that comes up in the House once it reconvenes. I can't see Alan Lawrence for one moment, who asked those questions when he was the Solicitor General, not getting after it now that so much has been exposed in the McDonald Commission report.
But your friends in the Liberals have just wiped out the whole McDonald Commission report by getting Wishart Spence to say, the former Supreme Court judge, that the McDonald Commission was wrong. The Mounties can do anything they like as long as there's no intent to be a criminal.
It's not up to any Supreme Court judge.
But that's what the Liberals
retired.
That's what the Liberals did.
Who retired to give his opinion on that. Where it should be is in the courts of the land right at the present time.
And the Liberal government has already decided to set up this new spy system headed by Fred Gibson or Wilson or somebody without the report even being debated.
Well, I'm sure it will be once we get back into the House. The problem, one of the major issues... one of the major issues that I think is that the House should be in session right now. There's no reason in the world why the government, given the tremendous difficulties in the economy, haven't called us back in order to get Parliament to agree to take certain measures.
Well, Mr. Trudeau had to go on his North-South trips, didn't he?
Well, he's got a few lined up before the House resumes, that's sure.
Sure, you can win the West in the next election, Flora, no problem.
We'll win Ontario. I can assure you the mood in Ontario has changed dramatically.
But not Quebec.
Oh, look what happened in the recent by-election.
Rush, let's
There's out. A mood. Yes, and it's very true that Rock is a popular person, but he won by 580 votes in 1980. He won by 13,000 this time. That's more votes than all Conservative members have gotten Quebec in the last 10 years.
My thanks to the ever-gracious Flora MacDonald, whose age shall remain a secret, unless you were listening earlier on. Next, two gentlemen from PIPSC, Professional Institute of the Public Service of Canada, with their hands out for bigger pensions after the break. Can I have some hot coffee, please? A couple of guys here now want to cut my throat. One is John Donegani, who is from the Professional Institute of the Public Service of Canada, and his title is?
President.
President.
And the name is Jack.
Jack, well, Jack, John. Oh, it says Jack Donegani. And your name, sir?
Joe Clare.
Joe Clare. Right. And what's your title?
Regional Representative.
Indexing of pensions is an impossible dream, in my view. Highly unfair. The only people who have them for sure and for whom the money is available to pay are all those lucky federal and provincial civil servants and crown corporations, and of course the MPs, the senators, and the rest of the boys who can write their own legislation. For a number of years I've been saying out very bluntly indeed, I don't mind index pensions if they're capped at a reasonable level, and if the ordinary man in the street could get them as well. The ordinary man in the street doesn't get an indexed pension. The ordinary man in the street's pension halves at a 10% inflation rate in a few years. The lucky civil servant's pension doubles with a 10% rate in a few years. Are my facts incontrovertible?
That's absolutely correct. The public.
Correct.
No, your facts are going to be questioned right now. I don't have to defend the facts anyway. The facts will speak for themselves. But the fact is that public servants pay 7.5% of their income into a pension plan, that the government in the 1950s established a pension plan scheme that became slowly introduced in legislation for pension standards in the private sector, not the indexing, which we'll get to, but in the 70s, indexing was introduced. Now, I think that every individual in this country deserves an indexed pension plan, because people who work should not be penalized when they retire because of inflation, over which they have no control. But the one big difference is that in the public service, people have paid 7.5% into a plan, where in the private sector, most plans are employer-sponsored, and those who are not pay a lot less than 7.5%. And the one main fact, and this is a fact that speaks for itself, is that in the past years, for every $2 that have been credited to the pension plan based on the contribution by a public servant and the interest on the plan itself, only $1 has gone out to pay for the indexing portion and for the annuities. So the employer's contribution to this plan has not even been touched. And therefore, I say to you...
Up to now.
Up to now and into the future, because the plan is self-generating. The interest itself earned on the plan last year was sufficient to pay any outflows out of that.
Is there real money in the plan, or is it merely a government book entry?
When you write a check to somebody, is that real money?
Is it used by the government in its general revenue expenditure, or is it a fully funded plan?
It's not a fully funded plan,
no.
But the comparison is with the private sector in that funds have to be fully funded, because if you're working for Company X, you have no idea whether Company X will go belly up in 20 years.
Okay, the federal pension plans are not fully funded plans. We're agreed on that.
But the argument is a fallacious one. Because the government takes the money that's credited to the account, puts it in 20-year government savings bonds at a rate of interest, which is being credited to the account at about 8% a year. Now, you tell me what pension investor has the funds earning 8% a year at this time?
None.
Is
it a fact, though, that when you have an ordinary pension from a company, whether you've contributed it or not, that it's not indexed?
Some companies have index plans, but many do not. Indexed. And that's a shame of the pension industry.
I know of only one. Shell has an index pension plan.
And I think it's time that people who work for these companies stand up and look at the pension industry. Interest rates are running way ahead of inflation, so every single pension plan is generating sufficient profit that the company is able to cut down its contributions to a plan. But we pay for ours, and we're not ashamed of that.
I'm not saying I'm right, I'm just giving you an opinion. What was the inflation rate you got in your pension last year?
The indexing rate? The last indexing rate was 8.9% in January 80.
What was it the year before?
Be less than 8.9%, I don't know.
What will it be next year?
Be a little bit more than 8.9%, but the interest rate in this country is far above the inflation rate, and therefore, when the government puts this money into 20-year Canada savings bonds, it's subsidizing the taxpayers of this country because that money goes into general revenue, which would otherwise have to be raised through taxes.
I'm agreed. We're agreed in that point, that it's not fully funded because the contributions the government makes to the fund on paper, in fact, come from general revenue as needed to pay pensions.
The funds, that's not correct.
That's not true.
That's not correct. The amount of money that is credited to the account is more than the amount of money that comes from the revenue account to pay for indexing. If the two accounts are put together, you would see that for every $2 that the account is both earning and the employees are contributing, pays $1 out, and the government's money that goes into the plan does not go to anyone.
What is the average, we're talking about the federal government, the average federal government pension presently paid at the moment?
$6,967.
A year? About $6,000 a year?
Close to $7,000. 69.
7, 12, 6, 72. Yeah. $7,000 a year. Roughly. That's the average pension.
Right.
With the increase, however, the incredible increase in civil service salaries on the higher end of the scale, we're going to finish up like Britain, aren't we? With very well-paid civil servants at the higher end retiring on very high pensions, just like MPs.
Well, Mr. Webster, I'm president of a union that represents 31 bargaining units in the public service, professionals in the public service, and I challenge that the rates of pay in the public service have been going up high. Now, you're talking about the examples that our friends the National Citizens Coalition bring out about a deputy minister.
They're
here
true,
or there.
They're true, though. They happen to be true.
Okay, but that's a red herring. We're talking about the bulk of the public service, whose salaries are not ahead of the private sector,
what is a postie
whose pensions
mate?
Are.
What is a postie mate nowadays under the new agreement?
I'm not sure what the salary of a
$23,600.
But I can tell you that the average salary for a computer programmer in the government is slightly less than $25,000 a year, and in the private sector, you're looking in excess of $30,000 a year.
Well, I know the levels in the British Columbia government and the levels of the assistant deputy ministers and supervisors and whatnot would choke a horse, and I'm sure they're not any better paid than the federal ones. And the examples that this coalition gave, and I don't like the coalition, of our top civil servants being paid more than the U.S. top civil servants, tell a story.
There are 300,000 people in the public service. You're talking about 2,000 people at the top who are very close to the politicians. You're talking about MPs' pensions.
Do you think MPs' pensions should be indexed?
No.
No? Do you think senators' pensions should be indexed?
I think all pensions should be indexed.
No. You know, we can't afford it.
No, and I'll tell you why I don't think MPs' pensions should be indexed. Because they don't put in the kind of service that public servants are required to put in. It's not that I'm against them having index pensions or any kind of pensions.
I'm against the two-class system. I'm against the system whereby the working man's pension halves down the road and the government employee's pension doubles.
I agree with you entirely, and it's about time that I think that everybody who is working for a living stand up to the private pension industry and make them deliver on index pensions.
Couldn't do it without total socialism.
No, you cannot. That's not true. Total capitalism will provide this. The interest rate, as long as interest rates run ahead of inflation rates, which is a pretty standard procedure, funds will make more money than it costs to index. Now, we're not saying that the working person should get a free ride. Let him contribute to the plan, just as public servants are contributing to the plan, but let the plan be designed so he can do this.
After the break. There's no doubt that for many, many years, the federal and provincial civil servants were on the low end of the money and on the low end of the pensions. Let me ask Mr. Clare, isn't it?
Yes.
Did you have to bargain your index pensioning rights?
No, we don't have any bargaining rights with respect to pensions, none at all. In fact, the Public Service Staff Relations Act, which governs collective bargaining in the public service, prevents that, specifically prevents bargaining about pensions. But the other point I wanted to make is this. The Canadian taxpayer, at the moment and in the past, has not paid in any money for public service pensions. Now, I'm talking federally. There has been enough money paid in by the employees alone, together with interest on that money, to pay the pensions in force to date. That isn't generally realized.
Was that the rates, the interest rates applied by the government in its investment of your contributions?
Yes, that's right. It paid interest on that money. And I might say it has never paid the going interest rate. By statute, by law, the interest rate on a pension fund, that's the Superannuation Act, the regular pension
right.
fund, is 4%.
Right.
Now, in addition to that, the government pays the average of Canada bonds over a 20-year period. Now, to begin with, I don't think there are any 20-year
no.
bonds,
mm-hmm.
so they take the average, which means it always has to be below the going rate. Now, just supposing that they were paying the going rate of about 20% today, mm-hmm. that fund would be self-generating. We wouldn't have to pay anything anymore.
So in effect, your indexing is capped by this provision whereby the average, the Canada Savings
no.
Bond
no,
rate.
No, no,
that's,
no,
that's
no,
not
no.
correct. That's,
no.
that's the rate that the fund earns.
That's right.
Okay, the investment, there's about $10 billion now in the pension fund contributed by public servants since the fund came into existence.
None from the government.
And a government matching contribution into the fund. But on a cash flow basis, each year, what the employees put in plus the interest on that account are more than enough to pay twice what goes out. But mm-hmm. the fund is earning an interest based on a 20-year moving average of Canada Savings Bonds. And new money going in is earning less than 13%, but the average interest credited is 8%.
Yeah, the point you're making to me, which I must accept, at least for the moment, is that the government and the members' contributions are paying the shot.
No.
The government and the members' contributions over the history of the account make up the amount of the account. That account earns interest. But the members' contributions plus the interest earned on the account are twice that which is paid out of the pension account and the indexing account.
How long is it going to last?
It's going to last forever because the account is self-generating on this basis. And if you look at the total that has been drawn out of the account, the employer's contributions never have been needed.
You were lucky to get them, weren't you?
I don't think we were lucky to get them, but one thing, as you were alluding to before, about bargaining, before 1967, when collective bargaining came into the public service, there was an agreement that if we did not bargain pension plans, the government would not make any unilateral change. And one thing we're very concerned about is the reaction of the government of Canada to pressure groups like the National Citizens Coalition, because there's one disadvantage of being a public servant. There are many advantages, but there's one disadvantage. Your employer never defends you. You're a political football for your employer, so you have to fight both the external criticisms and you have to fight the criticism from your employer.
Well, I think of the civil servant now as being the upper class.
Well, look, not in the federal sense.
The 75-hour weeks,
it might be,
the Y days.
Maybe out in Lotus.
You got Y days.
Maybe in Lotus
75-hour weeks, Y days. What's the other thing where you can arrange your own time? You know, great holidays, great benefits,
37,
index pensions.
Yeah. 37 and a half hours a week is what a public servant works.
No
plus,
pressure.
Plus.
You know, Jack Webster arranges his own holidays, too, takes months off in the summer.
I'm a huckster. I live or die by my efforts.
I know, so
I have no security.
But you actually live and die by the efforts of people we represent. Are you confident when you eat a steak that it's safe to eat? We have veterinarians making sure of that. Are you confident when you go to a drugstore to buy drugs that they're safe to buy?
No, I'm not confident.
Well, you're still here, so you're
no, I'm not confident. And I can tell you many other areas of federal concern where I am not in the least bit confident. I've tried on occasion to get information from government departments on my personal affairs and found an close to damned impossible.
We're in favor of freedom of information in the public service, and we have the same concerns about the people who are running the government. But we try to serve the public by making it run in spite
of...
Give
me an example of a well-paid civil servant of what has happened to his pension in the last few years, instead of talking about these nebulous averages.
I don't know what you call a well-paid civil servant.
A retired RCMP inspector with 25 years service.
Well, I don't know what his pension would be. I don't know what his rate of pay is.
I have a damn good idea what his rate of pay is.
But I'll tell you something else, Mr. Webster, is not evident in the private sector. His pension is average over the last 6 years, or the best 6 years of his earning.
That's
which
right.
means in today's inflation, it's reduced by 25% before he even gets it.
He gets 60% of it, doesn't he?
But it's a 25% reduction just because of inflation and the six-year averaging.
But over the next 3 years, he'll catch it up and beat
it. He'll never catch it up.
He'll get 10, 10, and 10. That's 10, 22, 35 right away in three years.
No, he doesn't do that.
Indexing is cumulative, surely.
I know it's cumulative, but you're distorting the facts. Just a moment now. Look, you said about an RCMP inspector with 25 years service. That was your example, right?
Right.
First of all, he gets 50%. And what does he get 50% off? He gets 50% of the average of his best 6 years. That's a reduction in the below the leaving salary of at least 20%. Now, it's that figure, 20-25, so he's now got around 75 to 80% of his salary. That's the figure that gets indexed. He never gets that other 25% or 20%.
He's indexed forever, though, as long as he lives.
Sure, he's indexed forever, but
and at 9% in 7 or 8 years, his pension will double.
He does not get the CPP on top of his pension, which every other person in private sector gets, because his pension's reduced by the equivalent amount of the CPP.
How long before your pensions double as a retired federal civil servant on indexing? That's all I want to know.
Well, that depends on the going interest rate.
9%.
I have no idea. You must know.
Okay, right. Not 9%. Okay. I would take a guess that that would be somewhere around 15 years. But if...
No. Way below 15
okay,
years.
Okay,
no.
But the account itself, which has more than what is being paid out of the account, twice as much, is going to increase the pay for this.
It's about
my apologies years. To these gentlemen, Mr. Donegani and Mr. Clare. They have a perfectly good point. Everything they do is perfectly proper. I merely have taken the awkward view that there is one group of Canadians who get their pensions doubled and another group is yet unprotected. Correct?
No, it is.
Take the break.
Everybody should have indexed pensions.
Everybody should have indexed pensions.
Right.
Don't forget, write to me, clearly, if you have a good story. Secondly, the rebroadcast is on check at midnight. Don't miss it. And this is Monday. And I'll be back tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely. That was a long 20 seconds. Let it go.